Hello again, everyone. Welcome to Washington Gun Law TV. I'm Washington Gun Law President William Kirk. Thanks for joining us. Well, I told you guys after I did this video right here that I would slow it down. I'd do a real thorough reading of the ruling in the matter of Hartford v. Ferguson and the denial of the statewide injunction out of the Western District of Washington, kind of do an autopsy of the case, really kind of digest it and understand, and then I'd get back to you and let you know. I've had an opportunity to do that, and candidly, I got to tell you, I'm really alarmed. And I'm really alarmed because I think that this video is gonna have relevancy not only to all of us in the state of Washington, but I actually think a lot of people around the country need to understand the arguments that were accepted here by the court and where the court went here. Because I think that there is a lot of reasoning in here that's gonna pop up over and over and over. Not because it's good reasoning, no, it's terrible reasoning, but it got the court the desired result that they wanted. So today, let's slow it all down for a few minutes and let's do some instant replay and talk about the worst Second Amendment ruling this year and why it matters to all of you. Okay, so the case we're talking about yet again today is the matter of Hartford v. Ferguson. We already did this video right here where you know that the injunction out of the Western District of Washington was denied. Now, just to get you all up to speed, Hartford v. Ferguson was one of three suits challenging House Bill 1240, which is now codified as Washington's assault weapon ban. This one resides in the Western District of Washington, United States District Court down in Tacoma. Now, as you all know, because you've watched the video already, the injunction was denied, but I've had an opportunity to more thoroughly go through the opinion, and I'm really worried about the reasoning that the court used. It's quite ridiculous, and you're gonna roll your eyes, and you're gonna wanna vomit, so get the barf bags out for this. But I want everyone to be aware of this because I do believe that you're gonna start seeing this exact logic pop up in other memorandums and other opinions around the country, and everyone needs to be aware of this. Now, as we previously discussed in this video right here, the two big obstacles if you're trying to uphold an assault weapon ban, of course, is the Bruin opinion, but more specifically, the Heller opinion and the common use doctrine, which flows from District of Columbia v. Heller. One of the things that the court did right away in this order was begin to distinguish and to minimize the impacts of Bruin and Heller and to kind of distort and dilute the holdings of them as follows. The plaintiffs misread Heller and Bruin. Heller noted that the right to keep and bear arms protected under the Second Amendment is limited to the sorts of weapons in common use at the time. It found that this limitation is supported by the historical tradition of prohibiting dangerous and unusual weapons. Heller does not hold that access to all weapons in common use are automatically entitled to Second Amendment protection without limitation. Further, under Bruin, if plaintiffs demonstrate that their proposed conduct, that of buying and selling weapons regulated by House Bill 1240, is covered by the Second Amendment, the Constitution presumptively protects that conduct. This presumption can be overcome. Now, one of the things the court basically did is say, hey, you know what? We're not going to find that the semi-automatic rifle that's subject to these assault weapon bans is actually in common use. They actually came to the conclusion that the plaintiffs in this case had failed to demonstrate that these particular firearms are in common use. Their reasoning was as follows. They point to court cases in which the number of assault weapons in the United States is discussed. However, the plaintiff's submissions failed to submit any evidence in the record before this court. Their showing is marked by argument without citation and sources showing that their argument would be supported by admissible evidence, even under the relaxed rules for preliminary injunctions. It is wholly unclear whether all of the weapons, like conversion kits or semi-automatic pistols regulated by HB 1240, are in common use based on the plaintiff's scant submission. The plaintiffs have not made a clear showing of evidence that supports their contention that all of the weapons covered by HB 1240 are in common use and therefore not unusual. The court went on to then say, but you know what, even if they are in common use, there is an abundance of historical analogs that justify this regulation. The authority, of course, that they use to justify this reasoning is two recent cases from the state of Illinois, and another case that upheld Delaware's similar ban. One of the other things that the court did over and over and over was rely solely on the opinion of one defense expert, a Dr. Spitzer. In fact, nowhere else in the entire order is any of the other expert testimony offered by any of the plaintiffs or defendants mentioned except for Dr. Spitzer. And one of the things that the doctor was very clear on is that there was a long, rich history of being able to regulate these types of firearms, and that the courts in Illinois had already acknowledged that. The court specifically ruled, the Beavis court that was considering whether a state or local ban on the sale of assault weapons and related accessories violated the Second Amendment, examined over 50 examples of arms regulation from the colonial era to the early 20th century, including those that HB 1240's proponents point to here. Now, one of the great debates following Bruin is that when we take a look at historical analogs, do we need anything in American history, or do we have to go back to the adoption and ratification of the Second Amendment, which puts us in the late 1700s? The court here clearly said, hey, listen, if you could draw from any historical analog any time in American history, that is enough to support the ban. The court's specific ruling was, in response to the rise in crime related to automatic weapons, in 1934, Congress enacted the National Firearms Act, which imposed extensive regulations on fully automatic weapons. Later in 1994, Congress passed the Violent Crime Control Act of 1994, which imposed a 10-year ban on semi-automatic assault weapons. In part, it prohibited the manufacture, transfer, or possession of assault weapons. Even these late events are part of an assault weapon regulation in the nation's history. And then the court went on to further state, each of the above arms restrictions, including bans and restrictions on carrying, arose from the same historical pattern. The weapon was invented, perhaps for the military, became widely popular with civilians, was associated with criminal use, and was then regulated by the states. And so you begin to see the court start to carve out this exception that if the firearm was originally developed for military use and then transferred into the civilian marketplace, that makes the firearm, which is now called extremely or exceptionally dangerous, okay? And apparently this new rule of law created by this judge on this case means that if a firearm is deemed to be exceptionally dangerous, well, none of the other rules apply. Now the court, in defining what makes this firearm exceptionally dangerous, clearly demonstrated their absolute lack of understanding of even the basic fundamentals of how firearms work. Take a look at this quote. Semi-automatic weapons represent a significant technological change. They allow a shooter to fire as fast as they can pull the trigger, unlike previous guns. What previous guns were that? And so it is that premise by which the court is operating. Now, the court went on to further then state, these weapons are exceptionally dangerous. Regulation of assault weapons and their dangerous accessories, as House Bill 1240 regulates, is arguably consistent with our nation's history and tradition of exceptionally dangerous arms regulation. And of course, the problem is that there is no legal theory about exceptionally dangerous firearms. It is a fabricated legal theory that comes from this opinion in the Western District of Washington on an injunction. And one of the reasons that the court says, listen, we didn't see complete bans when we go back and we look at more relevant history in the late 1700s and the early 1800s, was simply that the state just didn't have the maturity and the infrastructure and the resources that was necessary to implement those bans. Had they had those things, well, we would have seen bans earlier on. That is actually a finding of the court. Ultimately, what this court did was rely on the very two-part analysis that the Bruin court soundly rejected. It says if this judge never read the Bruin opinion and decided we needed to revive this two-part analysis. Don't believe me, this is an actual quote from the opinion. The burden imposed by both the historical regulations and HB 1240 are relevantly similar. They impose comparable burdens on the right of armed self-defense, and those burdens are comparably justified. The burden of HB 1240 on armed self-defense is slight. The proponents of HB 1240 have pointed to evidence that assault weapons are rarely used for self-defense. Moreover, the burdens imposed by the historical regulations listed above and HB 1240 are comparably justified. All were enacted to respond to public safety concerns regarding weapons considered to be extremely dangerous. So that just gives you a preview of where this court was coming from. Now, I'm not going to name the judge. I will tell you that it was a conservative appointed judge, but rules of professional conduct are going to just keep me from mentioning the judge's name. But hey, you could look it up. But what I want all of you, even those of you outside the state of Washington, to be aware of is that this is the type of reasoning and arguments that are likely going to come your way when you have result-oriented judges. The case, once again, is Hartford v. Ferguson. It is the order denying the injunction. We will put the link for that down below in the description box. If you guys got any other questions about this or anything else related to your Second Amendment rights, you guys should know how to contact Washington Gun Law by now. But if you don't, that's okay. That information is down there in the description box also. In the meantime, I do want all of you to remember that part of being the lawful and responsible gun owner, like we talk about all the time here, is to know what the law is in every situation, how it applies to you in any instance that you may find yourself. Until next time, thanks for watching. Stay safe.